In another few minutes, we'll be on live stream.
Okay.
We are live now, ma'am.
Okay.
Few minutes.
Okay.
Good evening all and good evening ma'am. Let's wait for another few minutes so that viewers can join with us.
Okay.
Good evening all. On behalf of Indian Medical College, I welcome you all to this online class. In today's session, we have Dr. Deepa Bappan, Associate Professor of Microbiology from SR Medical College and Research Center, Trivandrum, with us today. She is having 17 plus years of teaching and research experience in microbiology. She'll be taking class on coronavirus today. Good evening, ma'am, and welcome, ma'am.
Good evening. Thank you.
It's a great honor to have you here with us, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Yes. Dear viewers, the live chat session is enabled along with this live stream. If you have any doubts, please type them in the chat session. Your queries will be clarified by her at the end of the session. Ma'am, you can now share your screen to start the presentation. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for the introduction. Good evening all, and first of all, I'm thanking the Indian Medical College teachers, this platform, for giving me a wonderful opportunity to teach my enthusiastic students. So we will start our session about coronavirus. So you all have heard the word coronavirus, very familiar nowadays for the last 3 months. Even COVID-19, we are coming across. So we'll have a microbiological aspect. We'll have a short look about the microbiological aspects of coronavirus. So first, we'll go to this clinical history of a coronavirus. Please see, a patient of 53-year-old get a recent travel history from UAE 1 week back and presented with a 3 days of fever and cough with coarse breathing sounds of both lungs and at a body temperature about 39 degrees Celsius. And he was actually quarantined for 28 days in his house in Kerala. So the probable question you can get from this case history, what can be the probable diagnosis? What is the morphology of the etiological agent? What is his mode of transmission, its pathogenesis, laboratory diagnosis? Is there any accurate treatment? And what are the prophylactic measures? So we'll go one by one. So we'll move. So we'll see, what are coronaviruses? Actually, it is not a new terminology. We all heard these terminology from last long years. So actually, they are from a RNA group of viruses. They are a family of RNA viruses. And one more important factor is, it is of zoonotic origin, that is transmitted from animals to man. So that is why it is known as zoonotic, and it is a large group of viruses. It is a RNA virus. And not only it infecting man, it can infect mammals and even birds and cause illness ranging from a mild common cold to a severe disease like severe acute respiratory syndrome, or even now we are what we are seeing, the COVID-19 disease. So now you can have a look idea, that is, what is coronavirus? It is not a single virus. It is a group of viruses, and it's a large family of viruses, which can cause a mild illness to a severe acute respiratory syndrome. Okay, then we have to see, what is the morphology of the virus? So that is the second question, which I put in the first slide of case history. What is the etiological age and morphology? So what is that morphology? That is, it is an enveloped virus with a positive stranded RNA, and it got a very large viral RNA genome. And now we'll see why we call them as corona. You all heard about the word corona, that is our solar corona. Actually, the prefix comes from the Latin word, means crown. Okay, so we can see the solar corona, this picture, this is our solar sun, with having the solar corona-like structures, or that is crown-like picture. So from the similarity of the structure of this virus, it got the name corona, that is on the surface of the envelope. You can see this is a virus structure. Surface of the envelope, there are club-shaped projections that resemble a solar corona. They are known as the envelope glycoproteins. They are very conspicuous petal-like structures called peplomeres. So that is why they got the name corona. Oh, it is clear to my students. That is corona. It is actually the word meaning of crown. The surface envelope containing the spikes or projections, or otherwise known as peplomeres. That is why the surface envelope glycoproteins gives this shape to the structure, this virus, and that why it's got corona its name. Okay, so this is how the detailed structure is an important aspect you should remember in your question, in your exams. That is, you should draw. Hope those who completed the virology, that is especially influenza, you can remember the similar structure except the segmented RNA. So these are also the peplomeres you can see in influenza also. So this is how the SARS-CoV coronavirus 2 or coronavirus resembles. So how this, you can see the genome, RNA genome, which containing the nuclear protein, and you can see the envelope, and the envelope containing the small membrane proteins, and that is that yellow color. Then comes a blue color, that is, you can see the hemagglutinin esterase. Then comes the membrane proteins, and the last one that I told you, the peplomeres, that are the spikes, that is the envelope glycoprotein spikes. So together, this we can say this is the structure of SARS coronavirus 2, or we can say this coronavirus structure. So next we'll go to the classification. So you know that I told you already it is a large group of virus family. So we will go to the human infecting. That is, we will give more importance to the human infection now. That is about the classification. There are about 7 coronaviruses causes human infection in man. Among the 4 of them can cause mild self-limiting respiratory condition like common cold or flu. But the rest 3, that they can cause fatal pneumonias. So that is why we are coming across these years. The first one, that is the SARS coronavirus. It happened, the outbreak in China in 2002. Next comes the Middle East coronavirus, MERS. It happened in 2012 and 13. That is in Saudi Arabia. Next, the last one, the novel SARS coronavirus 2 or SARS coronavirus 2 from 2019 onwards, Wuhan from China. So this is how the brief classification of coronaviruses you can see. Next, how it is named. Then why we say we didn't put it as SARS only. We put it as something more it is added, SARS coronavirus 2. That is, in 2019, from Wuhan, the world came to know about a new virus that is similar to coronavirus. So they put the name on January 7, 2020, a novel coronavirus. Then after the detailed genomic sequencing, they renamed as SARS coronavirus 2. So, and the disease it was caused named as COVID-19. Or coronavirus disease 2019. So the hope the student, that is, you should remember the disease name is known as COVID-19 and the virus name is known as SARS coronavirus 2. Hope you understood how the naming of the virus or how the disease of the virus we can call it as. So it is named by WHO, World Health Organization, and now we call it as SARS coronavirus 2, and the disease is known as COVID-19. Then coming to the epidemiology, that is, most commonly it occurs in winter and early spring. That's in main, its incubation period is about of average 6 days. It can range from 2 to 12 days depending upon the immune status of a person. So those who are quarantined, that is usually in the first lockdown period, we put the patients in 14 days quarantine time. That will not exclude the infection. Now that is that we are going to see. That is after 24 days or even 35 days also, the patients are coming with the infection, even asymptomatic infection. That is one another important factor which now we will face in the coming months in the world. That is asymptomatic infections. Asymptomatic patients are increasing. Very, very huge number of asymptomatic conditions are going on. So we can't say that is this much period only the patient will be able to propagate or transmit the infection. But ideally, 24, between that is 14 to 24 days is ideal. If the patient is symptomatic, we can say. Asymptomatic patients, we can't predict. That is in every clinical conditions, the same thing. So COVID-19 is actually, then how we see, it is transmitted. So the transmitted between people through the respiratory droplets and contact use, not through the airborne infection. That is, you should remember, it is through the respiratory droplets and contact use. That is, it can occur by direct contact from an infected patient or an indirect contact with the surfaces in the immediate environment or with objects used by that person. Example, if you are handling your patient in your clinics or you're handling a patient with a stethoscope or thermometer, that can also, even if it's not properly sterilized or properly disinfected, we can also transmit this through this indirect contacts. So that is why we're putting social distancing or stay home or stay safe, like that we are seeing. Then viral shedding can occur following recovery, but unclear. But till now, it is unclear what is its role of transmission. Studies are undergoing, so we should have more studies that has to be evaluated to give a clear picture about viral shedding after recovery. Then children and intrafamilial spread appear to be the most mode of transmission. That is why we put our country or world into a lockdown condition to stop traveling or stop contacting between each other to make a spread to the virus. Okay, so even I told you that spreading, even asymptomatic individuals are also increasing. When we take example of our, especially our state Kerala, the last 2 weeks, we have more cases from asymptomatic patients, not symptomatic patients. The last 2 weeks studies or the patients come with a PCR positive, most of them, that is among 12 patients, 8 of them are asymptomatic conditions. They don't have any symptoms. We randomly or we check those who have any contact or maybe they worked, the healthcare workers, we randomly checked and we got positive. So that is why we told you that asymptomatic condition will increase, that will increase more. Mostly we can hope that it will give a herd immunity also. Okay, then start of the epidemic. So it is not a new thing, all familiar. We started from a local seafood market, not to sell live or slaughter freshly hunted animals, bats, snake, pangolins. So it is from that SARS, even SARS also, the first outbreak of SARS in 2002, it is transmitted from horseshoe bat to a civet cat into a human. So that is actually the history. So same like history is taking, that is maybe bat from snake, so many things are going on, probabilities or possibilities are telling, but not even yet finalized. So many probabilities. So usually the thing will be, it is from animals to man. Okay, next comes to the one more important factor about this coronavirus. It is having tropism to epithelial cell. What is the tropism? That means affinity. So this virus got an affinity towards the epithelial cells of our respiratory tract and gastrointestinal tract. So that is why we are seeing the pathogenesis of severe acute respiratory syndromes, pneumonia, and even gastrointestinal complications of gastroenteritis, that is the patient manifested with diarrhea. So that is why this virus already had a tropism towards the epithelial cells. That is why these virus is showing these type of manifestations. Next, one more another important factor you should remember about corona, genetic variation and evolution of new strains. That we already discussed in the classification, the recent, how it is classified among the 7 human causing one, the 3 major which is causing fatal conditions. So because of the high frequency of disease, so So these are the two mechanisms which help this virus to make us cry. Okay, then coming to who are at risk. So that also you know, children, older adults, pregnancy, people who have undergoing any underlying severe medical conditions like heart, kidney, or lung disease, or even diabetes are at higher risk of group with COVID-19 conditions. And it is because we will not be able to specify with the age group. Because in age group, in young group also, they also having heart or kidney diseases, they can come have the infection. So the depends upon the immune status of the patient. That children or older adults or when pregnancy, we can be accepted, that is. And any youngsters with the other comorbidity conditions can cause this infection. Coming to the pathogenesis. So pathogenesis, these patients infected with the COVID-19 showed higher leukocyte count, abnormal respiratory findings, and increased level of plasma pro-inflammatory cytokines. I think you remember in my first slide, I showed the patient how the patient comes. That is a real patient which we had admitted in our state. That is, so that patient, how the pathogenesis, the patient started with the lower respiratory symptoms. So that showed higher leukocyte count, abnormal respiratory findings, and increased level of plasma, like inflammatory cytokines. So along this, the major pathogenesis, that is a severe pneumonia, the patient can go through a severe pneumonia, RNA anemia, any anemia, ground glass opacities, and even acute cardiac injuries. So that is how it becomes fatal. Okay. Coming to the symptomatic, that is respiratory disorders and systemic disorder. That is the symptoms we can say overall. The patient sometimes that having the mild common cold or flu-like symptoms, sometimes rhinorrhea, sneezing, sore throat. Then they sometimes can have a fever, cough, fatigue, or sputum with headache or dry cough like that, sometimes sputum production. And they can go to, suppose in this condition, if this patient's immune status is okay, he can recover, no problem. But if it is not like that, the patient can go through systemic disorders or even fatal conditions like pneumonia, hemoptysis, cardiac injury, hypoxemia, ground glass opacities, acute respiratory syndrome, dyspnea, and even diarrhea. So that is how the pathogenesis is starting from a mild condition to a major condition. Next, who should be tested? Actually, that was very controversial, but still so many, from this last 4 months, knowledge, we can say, no need of to test everyone. That is not at all feasible to any country. So now the strategy, our country's strategy or the world WHO strategies also, most people have mild illness, they can be stayed at home, no need to go to hospital, like a common flu, cold or a flu-like symptom, rhinorrhea like that, they can be recovered at to be staying house itself, and they can ask for the doctor's or clinician's help. Doctor or the healthcare workers can visit the home and take care of this patient. Suppose the patient is from the mild condition, if they're going to a worse condition, it has to be hospitalized very in an emergency basis. So testing, then come to the test, that is testing result may be helpful to inform decision making and contact tracing. That is actually what we in Kerala do. That is, this testing results may be helpful. We test the patients with the contacts, asymptomatics, those who are primary contacts, secondary contacts, that is for the contact tracing. That is actually one thing which we can, it is very beneficial from the method or strategy of testing. Then the decision of the test, about the testing, that depends upon the state or country or the local health department, that we can't say it is to be must like that. That depends upon several other factors also, but no need to test everyone with COVID-19. Mild conditions will not be, actually can be recovered soon, but those who will become pathogenic or fatal conditions has to be tested on day or to be treated. Coming to the laboratory diagnosis, that is actually the most probable aspect of microbiology. How you can diagnose, what is the laboratory evidence you get for your probable diagnosis. So usually, you all know in virology, what we are doing, the best thing is you do the electron microscopy. Next, the viral culture, that is viral isolation. Let's come to the serology, and next is the molecular virus. So these are the four major steps we should take for a virology investigation. Okay, we'll see the first one. What is electron microscopy? Can it be possible for a routine evaluation? It's not at all possible. Virus isolation, that is also not possible for a routine or screening or a diagnostic purpose, because that is very, very much precautions we have to be taken. It is very highly infectious virus, and that is very difficult. That is to maintain in a small ordinary laboratories. So that also we can be chosen. Next, reliable, that is coming to the serology and molecular tech. So now in COVID-19 or SARS coronavirus 2 condition, what we are taking is, you all heard, what is the method which we are using? RT-PCR, that is a molecular biology method. That is, we are detecting the RNA fragments or even the RNA of that virus in patient secretion. Okay, so other electron microscopy, virus culture, or serologies, they're not feasible or not possible. So usually the coronavirus, except the other thing, that is SARS and COVID-19, we can't use for these, all these isolation or like that. We'll get a rapid test. Rapid test means easier, that is more sensitive, and it is somewhat feasible to do also. So that is why we are depending upon the RT-PCR for this investigation. Then coming to the viral isolation. So I'm talking about coronavirus as well, not about the COVID-19. So coronavirus, usually it is very difficult to grow in cell culture. Very difficult, but we succeed. That is, by using human embryonic tracheal organ culture. That is, cell lines usually used for coronavirus cultivation. But in SARS, viromonkey cells are used. Okay, then another technology, that is microarray technology, indirect immunofluorescent antibody. So these are actually not the routine methods which we are using for coronavirus, COVID-19. These are the coronavirus. Now, coming to the direct detection, that is actually, I told you, PCR COVID-19. That is from the respiratory secretion of the patient, we are detecting the RNA by using the PCR technology. Then serology, that is actually one more test which is nowadays going to be operating, that is the serology detecting the antibodies, IgG and IgM. That is actually not started with for a diagnostic for a patient care, but it is, we have to check with this community outbreak. We use this serology of antibody level detection for to check the community outbreak in a population, not for a patient diagnostic this evaluation. If at all you are using for a patient evaluation, you should confirm it with RT-PCR. So that is how the strategy which we are following up. Next, a little brief about, so you all heard is how the sample should be collected. As a healthcare worker, you should know how the sample is collected for a COVID-19. You can also come across in your clinical practice in future, because you should know how to collect an nasopharyngeal swab from patient with a suspected can be performed. That is, it can be performed in a normal, regular room with the door closed. An examination room you can collect. But the one thing which you should remember is, healthcare provider should wear an N95 mask or high-level respirator or PPE. That is the personal protective equipment you should wear with a respirator. If it is not, Google eye protection, gloves, or even gowns should be used. That is the must thing. And you can use this normal room with a closed door, but you should use the correct personal protective equipment. And now this is how the picture we used in our country state for taking the booth, like public booth telephone. Hope you remember the previous old public telephone booth system. Like that, we put a booth-like structure. The patient can visit outside, and there will be no, that is the, it is baked with the glass. And there is no person-to-person contact, so it is more easy. And PPE, you know, after all, it is very costly. It is not available. Also, this much world pandemic is going on, so this is somewhat easy for the country to manage the condition. So these gloves or even this mask only can be removed, or no need of the entire PPE also. So this is one thing which we introduce in our hospital in our Medical College. Next, coming to the specimen collection. So that also is not going to the detail about, but as a medical student, you should know what is, how it is collected, what are the samples that have to be collected, how and where and when it has to be collected, how to be transported, like that. That minimum basic knowledge you should have. So that is why I put this picture. So this is actually the sample swab which comes with the test tube, the sterile swab, and it is added along with the viral transport media. The swab will not be sent like this, as you are seeing in fungal and bacteriological culture. It has to be sent in a viral transport medium, and along with the complete, that is, leak-proof container. It has to be properly wrapped and put in a leak-proof container, and has to be packed with gel packs, and it is a biohazard thing, highly infectious, and to be transported and stored with all biosafety levels. Okay, so coming to the specimen type and priority. Sometimes clinicians, we come across a confusion, which sample has to be taken properly. Okay, what are the, depends upon the patient condition, what is the proper suitable sample we have to collect. So the nasopharyngeal specimen, that is actually the preferred choice for swab for SARS-CoV coronavirus 2 testing. So the other acceptable samples are oropharyngeal swabs, or it is a nasal mid-turbinate swab also, and an anterior nasal specimen also, according to WHO and CDC. Then when the patient, we can clinically indicate that the patient is on mechanical ventilation, what we have to do? We have that to take the bronchoalveolar lavage, or then the lower respiratory tract aspirate, we can take a specimen. No need to take this swabs. And we should maintain proper infection control when collecting the specimens. Biosafety for handling and processing specimens from suspected case patients. That is very must. Even nasopharyngeal and a nasal mid-turbinate swab should be placed in a viral transport medium, or amides, or steward, or sterile medium also can be used. If it is not available, the viral transport medium is not available, sterile saline is also good, and can be transported and to be reached the lab without being. And if both nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swabs are collected from a single patient, that is actually what we are doing, the protocol, nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swabs has to be collected, and they should be combined in a single test tube and sent to the laboratory for testing with the proper precautions. Because you should consider every patient in front of you as infectious, so that biohazard biosafety level you should maintain in all your procedures. Okay, next, coming to the strategy. That is, this is actually the laboratory diagnosis. That is how laboratory medicine can help in this condition. That is SARS-CoV-2. Till now, suppose the patient is got infected, the first thing we should do the diagnostic by using diagnostic evidence only with the laboratory evidence with RT-PCR. No other test is accepted till now. Studies are going on. So many studies are going on, but not till all are under trial. Then epidemiological surveillance. That is, I told you, that is how vast it spread, or to come into the community, how it is affecting the community, or you can check the community outbreak, that also with the RT-PCR along with the antibody testing. That is actually accepted. Okay, next comes to the treatment. That is actually the second last question which I put in my first slide. What can be the accurate treatment? Is there any accurate treatment now? I don't know. There is no specific antiviral treatment recommended for COVID-19, and there is no vaccine currently available till which I'm speaking to you. I don't know in the next moment, because studies are going on world around. So we can be a success. So we'll wait. So treatment is symptomatic with oxygen therapy. That is, basically intervention can happen in case of severe fatal conditions. Mechanical ventilations or hemodynamic support has to be given. That is, depends upon the comorbidity of condition of the patient. We have to support. Supportive care of the patient has to be given. That is actually the ideal choice. Then, prevention. The best way to prevent illness is to avoid being exposed to this virus. That is actually the first thing. That's why all country or all world going for a lockdown. That is actually avoid the exposure to the virus. That is the one thing which we have to do the first, because it is a respiratory route. festival is avoid exposure to the virus. It is spread from person to person and between people who are in close contact with one another. That's why we told a social distancing about 6 feet inches. That is more than 6 feet inches we should keep to when coming in contact with people. So stay home, stay safe. That is actually our lockdown policy. So this is how the another method which you should make into practice. Usually we will practice like cup, when we cup or sneeze accidentally or very suddenly, what we will do, we will put our like this in your mouth or nose, but that is not possible because this virus is patient in your hand. You can touch, you are touching others, you are touching your body, you are touching the things which you are using, handling with your hands. So kindly try to practice this method, that is the flexor as arm, that is actually flexor, and you can use for making when you are sneezing or coughing. Try to practice gradually. And clean your hands, that is hand wash. That is actually the basic principle behind microbiology, hand washing techniques, hand washing. Every time when we are going to the infection control measures in the ICU wards and OPDs, we always insist about wash your hands, wash your hands, wash your hands before and after. So wash your hands often with soap and water for at least 30 seconds. That you will know if you are going to public place or blowing a nose or coughing or sneezing. If soap and water are not available, if you have a sanitizer, you have nowadays handy sanitizer are available. And also the now it is getting very shortage. 60% alcohol usually we can use. Our touching and nose, that is especially don't touch your face. That is a respiratory route. It will enter. And fumigation is actually what we are doing. Opening the markets or public places, the offices, the buildings, the shops, we are putting fumigation by using sodium hypochlorite. Then the that is the drugs which we are under investigation. We can't say that this is a choice of drug. This is a choice of drug. We can't say so many investigations or trials are going on. And the last one that up to now, that is the Remdesivir, that is actually what the drug which was used for Ebola, and it was under trial in Wuhan and US also. In vitro have good activity when they compare with the SARS and MERS also. So that is actually now somewhat we can say it is can be used as a treatment procedure. You must be aware about the chloroquine, that is a malaria drug, and it is reported very less efficacy, and there are so many complications also, and that also not a right choice till now. That is going on. Even acetaminophen, ritonavir combination, or acetaminophen, acidubin, even plasma therapy, interferon therapy, all are under trials and limited possibilities. We know that is till now we don't know what is the right choice, drug of choice of coronavirus. We can't say. So that is why don't make it fun. When you are writing the treatment part of your this question, or when you are when you observe, when you practice, you are don't think that this that I'm telling you to the MBBS students, that is don't think that okay I can use acetaminophen, okay I can use chloro, like that don't think like that. So all under trials, it has to be approved by FDA, EMR, so many countries has to be approved, so then only we can in use. So just all these are currently under investigation. Then vaccine, that also I told you, vaccines under trial going on. There is so many some success with adenovirus recombination. One vaccine was not approved. It is under trial and coming into a success. Final trial is going on. We can wait and see how long or how fast, because I told you this virus already it is mutated. That is the Wuhan strain is different from Indian strain. It is different from Washington or California strain. So that shows this virus recombination or the mutation effect, genetic variation. So that genetic variation is not easy to pick up a vaccine for all this. So that is why it is very difficult for us to discover a vaccine. So all under trials, we wait and see, hopefully for the best. And the first and foremost thing, prevention is better than cure. That already I told you in my prevention slide. Just remember, proper hand washing, close contact with those who are infected or not infected. and the close contact with others is when you are coughing or sneezing, or when you are doing publicly outdoors masks or your flexia, that is the coughing, practice of coughing through your flex elbow. This has to be maintained. This has to be followed in your lifelong practice. It's not only 2 or 3 days or for 1 month or 5 months or like that. It should, that is, man should practice all these things in the future. Yes. Okay, so that is about my this thing about the coronavirus. Thank you. And that is, you should remember the take home messages. I told you, I give a short outlook about the COVID-19 or coronavirus. You should give importance to the viral, that is the structure of the virus, how it is transmitted, what is its pathogenesis, how we can laboratory diagnose, and what is the treatment, and prophylaxis. So these are the main aspects you should give importance when you are dealing in a microbiology exam. So hope you got an idea, a little idea about coronavirus or COVID-19 disease or SARS coronavirus too. And so any, if you have any queries or any doubt, you can come to, you can ask, I'll be here. You can come into the live chat and you can type the questions. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the wonderful session.
Thank you. Thank you.
Viewers, if you have any queries, please post that in the chat session, which is enabled for you.
Okay. I can stop sharing?
Yes, ma'am. Let's wait for 2 minutes so that someone can post their queries.
Yeah, okay.
Ma'am, we got some query.
Yeah. If that I can answer there.
Yes, please, ma'am. You can answer him orally also, ma'am. No issues.
Okay. So the incubation period is 12 to 28 days. That is what Harish is asking. So, so the incubation period WHO says is 12 to 28 days. That is actually not confirmed, because I told you in our country also, in our state, Kerala also, we got patients after quarantine of 28 days, because after 4 days of quarantine, we got an infection. We got infection. That is mainly asymptomatic infections are going on. That is why we can't say that the incubation is up to like this average. We can tell. That's why we are putting the patient first on 14 days quarantine, next to come to the 20 days quarantine, like that. Now the scenario is changing. Asymptomatic patients are coming. After 48 days or 40 days or 36 days, we are getting patients of COVID-19 positive. So we can't say incubation average. We can say, that's why I told you, And normally the coronavirus average incubation period is about 2 to 12 days, like that. But this COVID-19 condition, it is varying. That is, WHO is telling, that is all the countries' evaluation, countries' strategies are actually, they're putting together an analysis they're putting. Now the scenario is getting somewhat changing. So we'll wait and see whether is it will be very accurate or it can be changed. Now we are also wondering, we are in dilemma, that is how we wondered how this, our healthcare workers, they are also getting. They don't have any incubation, they are not showing any symptom. So how can we say? And they, we are not able, that is, we are not able to contact trace or that healthcare workers' condition also. That's why I told you, incubation period average, we can say. That is very good for 14 days, 28 days quarantine. Now, quarantine is also not at all, actually we can say it is helpful, like the because the patient is get after quarantine 28 days, they are coming up, we are getting more cases. Okay. So next question, how many tests should we do in order to confirm he tests negative? That depends upon the patient immune status. And we have one case in Kerala, she got she become test negative after 48 days. She become positive and we started quarantine and started treatment. She become negative after 48 days. That depends upon the immune status of the patient. If you have a strong, healthy immune system, will become negative very fast. Otherwise, it depends upon the immune status of the patient, we can't say. That is why we are putting the testing more and more for those who are admitted with the positive cases, till they become negative. Okay?
Viewers, if you have further queries, you can still post on it in this chat section, or you can post it on your Facebook page. You can get answered later.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the wonderful session, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Dear students, thank you all. So we'll keep in touch with another session. Thank you.
Dear viewers, hope you all enjoyed this session. You can subscribe and share to our YouTube channel, and also like and share our Facebook page given here. You can access recorded videos, MCQs, and announcements of all the sessions of our Facebook page. And here is our upcoming session. We are going to have Dr. A.K. Jain from Rashtriya Medical Research Institute to deliver a special lecture on optics. Please stay tuned by 6:30 p.m. today. And we have the following sessions tomorrow also. Please stay tuned to our YouTube channel. Thank you all.